So good morning, everybody, and welcome to this 7th IMI Stakeholder Forum. We very much appreciate that so many were interested to come here today, and we are also joined by a lot of people who will join us through the web streaming, so we would also like to say welcome to you who are online. We have a full program through the day, and we hope that you are going to enjoy the day, the different speeches and sessions. There's plenty of opportunity through networking. As you know, we have for the first time an app, an IMI stakeholder app, that I hope that you all will log on to. And from there, you will find the information about all the sessions, all the speakers, participants at the meeting. You can use it by sending questions and comments, and also give us your opinion about what you think about the event. You can also follow us on Twitter throughout the day, and also, of course, on LinkedIn. So, without any further ado, I should maybe say I'm Irene Norstedt. I'm the Acting Executive Director for IMI, and I will be your guide through the day. And without further ado, I will actually introduce the welcome note, which is given by Rudolf Strohmeier, who is Deputy Director General for DG Research and Innovation, and he is also the Vice Chair and a long-standing member of IMI's Governing Board.
Thank you, Irene. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to welcome you to this 2015 Stakeholder Forum of the Innovative Medicines Initiative, IMI. This meeting is the first stakeholder forum since the launch of the second phase of IMI, named IMI2, in July 2014. Therefore, today's meeting provides us all a chance to take stock of some key IMI achievements, to look at the potential of IMI2, and to look to the future. As we are all aware, Europe faces many challenges related to health, in particular an aging population, while healthcare and other budgets get tighter. I'm convinced that the only way forward is through more and better research and innovation, and in particular, collaboration of all actors in healthcare is needed to ensure that the most important challenges are tackled and so that new innovations can reach the patients as quickly as possible. And this was the leitmotif of the Commission creating the first Innovative Medicines Initiative in partnership with the European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industries and Association, FPIA, in 2008, speeding up the development of better and safer medicines for patients. Also, biomedical research innovation has long timelines. We can already observe some of the first concrete results of this 7-year-old partnership. As first example, I want to mention the burning issue of the rising threat of antimicrobial resistance. IMI is paving the way in this era with its potential game-changing program on antimicrobial resistance, new drugs for bad bugs. The program is establishing a Europe-wide clinical network with more than 300 clinical sites supported by laboratories able to carry out high-quality clinical trials and epidemiology research. Several antibacterial compounds are now being tested for infections that are resistant to many or all existing medicines. A second example is that IMI activities have brought new insights into underlying genetic causes of autism, with major clinical trials for early detection and monitoring of autism in children. Thirdly, in the field of metabolic diseases, an IMI project has generated the first human pancreatic beta cell line, a very important tool for developing medicines that fight diabetes. All participants in IMI should therefore be proud of these achievements and many others that help address the health challenge in Europe and the rest of the world. The first session of today's meeting will further illustrate and analyze these and other success stories. The second session will then look closer at IMI2 and its novelties. IMI2 is designed to amplify the first successes and deliver new breakthroughs. With IMI2, we have gone a step further in establishing an even more ambitious framework with greater emphasis on accelerating patient access to new treatments, a bigger budget, and the potential for a broader partnership. Meeting the needs of the patients is at the heart of the IMI2 strategic research agenda. And this agenda is based on the WHO report, Priority Medicines for Europe and the World, and has been consulted on extensively with the public. IMI2 benefits from a total budget of close to 3.3 billion euro, half of which is from Horizon 2020, the EU's framework program for research and innovation. This makes it the world's biggest and most ambitious public-private partnership in health research. The principle that the large pharmaceutical industry does not receive EU funding is maintained. All EU funding goes to academia, SMEs, mid-sized companies, patient organizations, and regulators. As new features, IMI now addresses the entire health research and innovation value chain. Furthermore, the partnership is now open to industries beyond pharmaceuticals, such as diagnostics, imaging technologies, or animal health. IMI2 builds further on the successful collaborative approach that has proven to work so well under IMI, where all the necessary stakeholders are integrated in projects, which in general includes several companies. I'm very happy to announce today that IMI2 will soon be steered by a new executive director. I'm very honored that Dr. Pierre Meulien, currently present, a president and CEO of Genome Canada, has agreed to take office on the 16th of December this year. His long-standing experience with funding health research and innovation will be an important asset for the further development of IMI. But of course, I would also like to thank my colleague Irene Nordstedt for having taken over the position as executive director 6 months ago so successfully. She has invested considerable energy in ensuring the smooth translation from IMI to IMI2. As I have said, IMI2 puts patients right at the center of its priorities. I think it's only fitting that we now invite Mr. Anders Christensen, 18 years old, diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at age 1 and a half, to share his experience of this disease. He symbolizes the raison d'etre of IMI2. Throughout today, and indeed after this meeting, let us not forget his stimulating message to work towards a cure. IMI is Europe's partnership for health. It is above all a partnership for the patients and for our citizens. I wish you all a very informative, interesting, and inspiring meeting, and would like now to invite Anders to take the floor. Come to the stairs, Anders.
My name is Anders. I'm from Copenhagen, Denmark, and I'm 18 years old. I've lived almost all of my life with the burden of the chronic disease, type 1 diabetes, and I will continue to do so until science finds a cure for me and the 6 million other Europeans affected by this disease. But first of all, I want to thank you very much for the opportunity to address this assembly of stakeholders for the Innovative Medicines Initiative. It truly means a lot for me to be able to share with all of my struggles and challenges with type 1 diabetes, together with my hopes and visions for the future. The first part of my story, I was too young to remember, so it is based on what I've been told by my parents. It was in February 1998. I was 15 months old, and I had a bad cold after a winter vacation in Norway. I started being very thirsty, drank water all the time, and urinated 15 to 20 times a day. After some days where it had become just worse and worse, it became clear to my parents that there was something wrong. I was taken to hospital, and soon the examination showed that I had type 1 diabetes. My mom and dad, not knowing anything about diabetes, were devastated when they learned that their 15-month-old boy had to live with this disease for life. To be quite honest, I don't remember what it was like not to have type 1 diabetes. So for me, the constant finger pricking to measure my blood sugar, the insulin injections, and the discomfort and low and high blood sugars were just part of my life. The burden of and responsibilities was at that time more on my parents. As I grew older, I became more and more aware of the deep impact of type 1 diabetes in my life. I learned to follow therapy, which means measuring my blood sugar and injecting myself with insulin, both which have to be carried out many times daily. But I also soon discovered how frustratingly impossible it is to match all variables that determines what the correct insulin injection doses is, which is why people with type 1 diabetes on a daily basis experience blood sugar cycling up and down, discomfort, and occasions of dangerous hypo and hyperglycemia, which is low and high blood sugar levels. I do recall days with anxiety, sweat, and fear for hypo events with my body's requirement for insulin on these particular days were lower than usual, meaning that the usual insulin dosage that day in fact was an overdose. Sometimes my parents could handle it by constantly feeding me glucose tablets, apple juice, or honey. Sometimes I ended up in a hospital. I also recall many times not feeling good when the blood sugar was out of range, being moody, and not being able to play or carry out more sports. Let me try to explain why it is so. Well, first of all, type 1 diabetes is completely different from type 2 diabetes, as it typically hits in the younger years, randomly and completely independent of the personal lifestyle. It is an autoimmune disease wherein the insulin-producing beta cells in the pancreas, for unknown reasons, are attacked and killed by the body's own immune system. When that happens, you lose the ability to produce insulin. This is very serious, since insulin is the hormone responsible for directing nutrition in the form of glucose into the body's cells, which again means that the body in essence is starved to death. So before the discovery of insulin in 1921, type 1 diabetes was a death sentence. Sadly enough, this is still the case for people in the undeveloped world affected by this disease. So we have insulin. What's the problem then? The problem is that insulin has to be dosed very precisely, according to many variables, in relation to the physical and mental conditioning of the person. This requires attention around the clock in a constant and difficult balancing of food intake, activity, and insulin injections. If my blood sugar becomes too low, I risk insulin shock and coma. And if it becomes too high, my risk of developing debilitating complications increases. Even with the best treatment currently available, it is an impossible challenge to balance all the variables perfectly. It is simply too complex, and no other disease requires as much of the patient on a daily basis. Therefore, national treatment goals all over Europe are not reached, resulting in debilitating complications and overmortality. So what do we do? Since type 1 diabetes cannot be prevented by either a healthy lifestyle or in any other way, the only solution is research into a cure for the disease. And I would argue, while we wait for that cure, into better treatments, allowing us to live longer, safer, and better lives with type 1 diabetes. This is why I, with my head held high, can say that I was extremely grateful last year when I learned that the first call of IMI2 would focus on my chronic disease, type 1 diabetes. I know that I speak on behalf of all the millions of people in Europe with type 1 diabetes when I say that I hate this disease and all that it does to my body and my life. There's nothing we want more than to have this disease removed from our lives. And the greatest wish of our lives is that scientists will find a cure for type 1 diabetes. But what does a cure look like? Well, ultimately, it would be great if we, through a vaccine or similar, could prevent type 1 diabetes from developing at all. But likewise, it would be great if we, who already are affected by this disease, could be given a one-time treatment that would stop the immune attack and restore our lost beta cells. This is exactly what the first call of IMI2 is all about, and we're thankful for that. Unfortunately, I have learned that reaching these goals is still an enormous challenge, and not something to be expected within the next 10 or 20 years. So while I am truly grateful for the focus and effort, I wish that you, together with this, would put resources into research that could help us in the short term as well. My dad, who works with the JDRF in Denmark, have told me about the exciting research and progress on, for instance, in the field of stem cells and encapsulations. And while it is not a biological one-time treatment cure, I know that all of us with type 1 diabetes would be in heaven if we could substitute our current many daily blood sugar tests and insulin injections with a once-a-year small surgical replacement of a capsule containing insulin-producing cells, and then forget all about the disease until next year. And this technology is in fact already by now tested in humans in other places of the world. I think we in Europe need to focus on efforts like these as well. Because even if it's not a biological one-time treatment cure, it will indeed allow us to live longer, safer, and better lives with type 1 diabetes. While we wait for the biological cure, I also believe that the cumulative savings on treatment of complications on the European health budgets alone would pay for such efforts. Therefore, I ask you to please consider research into better treatments like macro encapsulations in coming IMI2 calls. It is time for me to round off. And I would like to do this with one sigh, one big thank, and one wish. My sigh is that I and 6 million other Europeans will still have to live with the burden of the chronic disease, for the foreseeable future at least. My big thank goes to all of you for bringing type 1 diabetes into focus through IMI2 first call. And finally, my wish that you will consider research into better treatments for type 1 diabetes in one of the next IMI2 calls. Thank you very much for your attention, and may you all have a pleasant meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anders, for that very powerful and passionate speech that I think sets the scene for all the work that we are doing and what we are trying to achieve. Thank you very much from all of us. It's now my pleasure to introduce Richard Bergström, Secretary General for European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industries and Associations, FPA, who is the partner together with the European Union in IMI. Richard, the floor is yours. Richard is also a long-standing member of IMI's governing board.
Thank you, Irene. The slight Nordic opening here with three Nordic people speaking. I'm sure that during the day this will be corrected. Good morning, everyone. As Irene said, I'm the Director General of FPA, so representing one of the two partners in this public-private partnership called IMI. I was present, as some of you know, when the global CEOs decided to agree this partnership with the European Commission. And they signed a piece of paper. The president of FPA had to sign a commitment for 1 billion euros of contributions to IMI. And there were very few details actually known about how this money would be spent or what it would be. Nevertheless, the leaders of my industry, they signed up because they believed in the idea that we should probably work much more together to deliver on the new science. And it's worthwhile therefore now to take stock a little bit and see, you know, how did it shape up? What did it become? Not only from a scientific perspective where we have certainly seen fantastic achievements, but also look at how do we work? How do these consortia work? Who's involved and who's not involved? And that's really the purpose of this session now that I'm chairing. We didn't know when we started the extent to which we would have the regulators involved, for instance. Now we have the European Medicines Agency. We even have the FDA informally providing ideas on what one should work on. You know, they are intellectually sometimes the drivers behind the new calls, I must say. We did not know to what extent patient groups would be willing or able to take part in shaping programs and scientific discussions. We see here now with the JDRF joining IMI, it's a big step forward, joining not only with ideas, but also with funds for future IMI programs. You know, so we now see that in more than half of our consortia, we have very active patient representation, and we have the regulators part of it. And the things I hear about, the things we are planning now, we have patients everywhere in all the programs, and we're going to have certainly regulators involved in most of them. The next wave of inclusion is now to look at health systems. Health systems with their payers, health technology assessment people, the people that are also part of maybe deciding on what is given to patients and not at the end of the day. So they need to be involved in aligning and you know, designing the future collaboration. So the pipelines of the industry and of, I think, public institutions are full of exciting science. There's a lot going on. This is, of course, a combination of working differently. IMI is one example of that, maybe the best example of that. But it's also a result of the technologies we have now. We have all the IT technologies. We have all the tools to do genome sequencing and to design medicines and biologics and vaccines in a different way. So we have these tools. But one thing that we maybe sometimes underestimate are the skill sets to deliver on these tools that we have. And before I introduce our first speaker, let me share with you a little anecdote. So Roxandra Dragacli, who is the Director of Health in DG Research, she's traveling with the Commissioner today. I believe she's not here. But she told me about a conversation she had recently with some big data people, because as the health sector is moving in this direction, and you will hear more during the day about this, as the health sector, which includes both health systems, our IT providers, and industry and others, you know, we have to think about how do we get our arms around all this data, because we need to link now our knowledge from labs about systems biology with real patients and their data and their samples and so on. How do we do this? And we have to handle a lot of data, a lot of data points. So Roxandra had this conversation with some of the people at CERN about how do they manage big data, because they handle big data. And they said, don't worry about IT. Don't worry about the computing capacity in Europe to manage all this. You can do that. Your problem is going to be skills to do something with the data. Where are the mathematicians that understand healthcare? It's the algorithm people, the people that analyze the data. So this is going to be the next frontier of retooling skill sets, is to link yet another discipline into my industry and into medicine's research. So training, skill sets, it has been a cornerstone of IMI from the very beginning. And I'm very happy that Mike Hardman from AstraZeneca is going to talk about how training has been part of the early successes of IMI, and I will continue to be a very important priority. So Mike leads the IMI EM train project, but he also oversees all the training aspects across all the IMI programs. It's something we built in IMI too, is that we have these horizontal, cross-functional teams to work with knowledge management, for instance, across. So Mike, please take the stage and share with us your thoughts on training, or looking backwards and also looking forward. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I must say I'm delighted to be here with you. I'd like to say a big thank you to the organisers. I'm especially delighted to be able to talk about my favourite topic, education training, and to represent my colleagues who are working in the various IMI education training projects. I think education training is probably one of the most important aspects of science, and I think Richard just alluded to why that's so important in the future. But let me just show you why. And when we've been thinking about education training, it's been very clear to us that without research, competent researchers, and I use the word competent very carefully, we wouldn't have the research. So the competent researchers are the cornerstone of all the work we're doing, whether that's in IMI or any other area. And many of you will be familiar with this, the knowledge triangle, where you have the research, the innovation and education closely linked and completely dependent on each other, and yet quite often we focus on some of the areas of innovation, or we talk about research, and we forget that the education training projects have to be there to support them. So when IMI 1 was set up, you'll be aware that there was a research agenda, a strategic research agenda. And that was looking very much at what we described as the bottlenecks, the gaps. And you'll see that education training was very clearly there supporting and integrated with all of the aspects of the scientific project, safety, efficacy, and indeed knowledge management. And we set up 5 IMI education training projects, shown there, European Medicines Research Training Network, EU2P for pharmacovigilance, PharmaTrain, SafeSciMet, preclinical toxicology, and one which is slightly different, EUPATI, which is the European Patient Academy, where the focus here was on supporting patients. This project is led by patient associations, and very much making sure that patients were in the centre of the research activities and able to support those research activities. So we knew what some of those gaps were, hence I put a big tick against symptomatic treatment. What we weren't aware of at that time was why some of these gaps had arisen, and indeed what we might need to do about it in the future. And I'll come to that in the second part of my story, which is more the future. And we're now aware that although we'd identified some of these gaps and addressed them very successfully, we too have the iceberg phenomena, where a lot of the education training needs, particularly the future ones, have not yet been addressed. But what did we do? There were clearly some short-term needs. You'll see here a depiction of the medicines overall development program from discovery through preclinical, clinical, all the way to the market and post-marketing surveillance. And we set up a number of projects which were specifically addressing some of those elements. And you'll see on the side there some of the most important features. We were looking at a very diverse community, and therefore this had to be flexible, it had to be modular. We wanted to make sure that we combined the best of the academic expertise and pedagogic training with the practical aspects, the day-to-day examples of what happens when you're working in medicines development. Hence the importance of the public-private partnership. Again, we wanted to make sure that these reflected the needs of people who are working in the industry, as well as those who might be coming in, and hence the flexibility in terms of the type of courses. And again, making sure that in terms of the learning methodologies, the requirements of different populations, that we had a whole range of e-learning, face-to-face, blended learning. And these were incorporated within those IMI projects. But we were also aware that we couldn't cover everything. And clearly there were many areas of medicines development which weren't part of courses, and hence within my own project, MTrain, we were looking to provide the infrastructure, the tools, the support that was necessary. And one of those you see here, which is OnCourse, a database with nearly 7,000 courses, short courses, master's courses, PhD programs, allowing people, as Michelle Goldman once described it, to navigate the jungle of courses and define what was most appropriate for their particular needs. And within IMI education training projects, we developed standards for these courses so that people could find the most appropriate courses. And we also included learning methodologies so that, again, these courses could be optimized for the different participants. Within the MTrain project, we included another element which was focusing on young researchers and particularly trying to produce a cohort of what we describe as industry-aware young researchers, those who understand both the academic environment and the industry environment, and those who are able then to partner and collaborate more effectively in the future. Let me just tell you briefly about some of our flagship courses. You can read some of this. This is Safe SciMet. This is predominantly looking at safety, preclinical safety, some elements of clinical safety, with a target audience as described here. And again, I'll pick out some of the features which make this different or which are additive features in comparison with some of the others. You'll see here that the focus again has been on real-life cases, bringing examples that people have been working on, helping people to understand how to solve those problems. And indeed, looking at this transitional aspect of safety sciences from molecule to patients. And Safe SciMet has continued to develop these ideas, is continuing to run these courses, and is now also looking at developing competency profile for safety scientists. If we look at the next of these flagship courses or areas, this was PharmaTrain, looking at integrated medicines development. Again, you'll see that this covers medicines development from molecule all the way through to marketplace and post-marketing surveillance. And again, I'll pick out some of the features here, which I think are particularly important. Here, the focus was on standards. Standards for the programs, standards for the centers, so that we have a range of universities. We have 14 centers of excellence, not just in the original European countries, but now in South Africa, and more recently in Osaka, in Japan, who are able to provide the same program because the standards have been developed. So PharmaTrain had taken this one stage further in terms of the globalization, and PharmaTrain had also focused not just on the knowledge acquisition, what you normally get from courses, but this next stage of competence development and developed a profile for those working in the area who might then want to continue and become specialists in medicines development. If we look at the next of our flagship courses, you'll see EU2P, Pharmacovigilance and Pharmacoepidemiology. Again, an extensive program covering all aspects that are required for people working in the area. You'll see it also covers a target audience of those who aren't experts, as well as those who are and wish to develop their expertise further. This program provides short courses, master courses, and the opportunity to do PhDs. And they are a distance learning program, so that people are able to participate in this program from anywhere in the world. If we look at the next of the programs, this is EUPATI, this is the European Patients Academy on Therapeutic Innovation. As I mentioned, this one is different. The focus here is helping patients and the public understand medicine's development, not diseases or products, and helping to build that expert capacity by providing the tools, this library of information in a variety of languages, and facilitating patient involvement in the R&D process. And if we look to see how EUPATI have done this, then it's been a very clear program focusing on building up this cohort of patient experts who are then able to work at all levels. Half of this cohort has already started its training program, and the second half will be starting soon. You'll see that there's then a cascade so that other materials are available, not just for the experts, but for those who are the advocates, and indeed providing a toolbox for of the order of 12,000. And then cascading this information down so that it's available as a toolbox of slides and videos and other information for a broad cohort of patients across Europe, and indeed anywhere, with over 100,000. And this program is up and running, focusing on what we've heard already today, the importance of the patients and their participation. The IMI projects have evolved. And Richard alluded to this, whereas we started as individual projects with our individual project programs, we quickly realized we had a lot in common and could actually be a lot more effective if we joined forces. And here you see we had the opportunity with additional IMI funding. This was the so-called Exploring New Scientific Opportunity Funding, the ENSO. And four of the projects, MTrain, EU2P, PharmaTrain, and SafeSciMet, joined together to form IMITrain. Patty works very closely with us, isn't a formal partner. So we have now a single website where you can access all of the information about the IM Education Training Project, about the courses, about career services, about services for course providers, making it much easier and allowing us to get much more out of that. But we hadn't addressed the root cause. And the root cause is that we live in a continuously changing world. It changes in terms of regulation, it changes in terms of some of the advanced therapies, it changes in terms of the science, it changes tomorrow, it'll change again next week, it continues to change. And therefore the challenge is, how do you provide education and training for researchers against this sort of background? And this is what we believe is the answer. This is maintaining professional competence so that every professional, and by that I mean everybody working in biomedical sciences, needs to develop and then maintain an optimal level of professional competence to speed up the development of better medicines for patients. And one of the ways of doing this is to build this portfolio, not just of knowledge, but of competence, of skills, of practical experience. And this then becomes the currency, allowing people to move across disciplines, to move across geographical borders, to move between industry, regulatory authorities, academia, having a well-defined description of what people are capable of doing. And this has been part of what the education and training projects have done under LifeTrain. So we've got the various stakeholders together. This isn't just the IMI projects. We have the course providers, we have the professional bodies, we have employers, we have individuals who've worked together to define the principles of what's required for this continuing professional development in this area, who have signed up to this. That means they've helped us develop it, and they will help us to continue to implement it. And this is the way in which we've been trying to address what we believe is this gap. And this is part of the root cause analysis, that we have in Europe a very sophisticated and exceptionally good higher education area, which focuses on academic training. And we also have in Europe, or would like to have in Europe, the best possible European research area. But there's a gap in terms of how we train and educate people when they move from one to the other. I think as Richard alluded to, we continuously see that there are gaps in skills that we need to fill as the science moves on, as we find that we don't have some of the mathematicians or the modellers or the people who can deal with advanced therapies. And that is a continuous challenge. So what we would like to look at for the future is building on the successes we've had so far, and those courses are some of the best courses which are available for people working in the area, but to build what we're describing here as a platform for researcher training, where we can join the European research area together and make sure that all of those projects from IMI or IMI2, or all of those projects from Horizon 2020, or all of those projects from research infrastructures or any other, have the optimal education training to make sure that the skills and the competences match the requirements as we move forward. But we're not alone. And this is where, somewhat unusually, I invite you to join in. We want you to be part of this, whether in academia, the pharma industry, SMEs, regulatory authorities, ministries, DGs, patient organisations, wherever you are, you can help in terms of making sure that these training programmes and the emphasis on training follows the science, so that we do have a well-educated, very competent group of scientists here in Europe to have better medicines that we need for the patients, including the wish of Anders earlier, that we can do something for these chronic diseases. So what can you do? There are a number of us here today you can talk to about IMI Train and our plans for the future. You can visit the website, please do. All the information is there, and we'd love to be inundated with information, requests, questions, etc. And if anyone would like to talk to me during the breaks, I would be delighted to tell you what we've been doing and certainly what we hope to do in the future. So with that, I'll say a big thank you to you, to everybody else, and look forward to being inundated with questions and having the website blocked by all of your visits over the course of the next few days. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mike. I think we will have time for questions and a discussion after the three presenters, I would suggest, so we know about how much time we have for that. Thank you very much, Mike. Thank you. So the education and training program is one type of activities in IMI. When we scheduled this session, we thought we would have three speakers that talk about three different types of programs, because there is a certain typology here. Another type of consortia in IMI deals with where companies and researchers get together to work prospectively on an actual project together. We are here a bit later about other types of IMI programs as well, where we share knowledge, and the sharing of knowledge and learning is the primary purpose of the consortia. Now we're going to look at a consortia which is about getting together and working forward-looking on concrete deliverables. And a very good example of that is the European Lead Factory. So Dimitrios Tsalis is going to talk about the European Lead Factory, and also, as he's coming from a small company, it's always sensitive to say someone as an SME, but you don't mind, you're nodding, so that's fine. An SME company, which also has benefited from this. So we will not only hear about these types of programs, how they work, but also how the SMEs come into play in the IMI consortia. So Dimitrios, thank you very much for coming.
Well, I would like to thank you for the kind introduction and the committee for having me over here to present the European Lead Factory. And I hope I can show you a little bit how we can, as a small SME, really make a big contribution to a large-scale project. Because the word small does not mean that we can only deal with small projects. The ELF has been the largest single-financed project of the IMI, financed with approximately 200 million euro, and SMEs have been in the driver's seat and have actually quite great successes achieved in the meanwhile. I'm as an SME, as I mentioned, we have 50 employees in the company. We're in business since 15 years. We are a typical CRO performing organic chemistry, and yet the commission entrusted us with a large project. And I hope that I can show you in the process that we didn't disappoint the commission here on this. But before I start my presentation on the ELF, I would like to take you on a journey that I took last year to Florida, to the Florida Keys. And it was quite interesting because I saw there a phenomenon, and it really is a phenomenon that the IMI is addressing. When you drive along the Florida Keys, it's a beautiful set of islands with beautiful beaches, each individual representing actually the science community in Europe. But if you drive along the highway, all of a sudden you see this phenomenon. And this is exactly what is happening in science and the drug discovery today. We have these very small roadblocks of, let's say, 20 meters on a highway of 200 miles. But if you hit that roadblock, the project stops. And this is exactly what is happening in the drug discovery world today. You have on one hand the academic world that reaches a certain point, and on the other side we have the pharmaceutical industry, and they are not connected. And how I see the IMI is forming the foundation for us to build the bridge for the partners to drive across. And at the end to reach our dream goal, which is Key West and the Florida Keys. And this is really symbolized quite well the journey that we took. And with that, I would like to switch over to the European Lead Factory. And the European Lead Factory is a great example that shows that you can improve creativity by putting together the best minds on one problem, that you do that without a formal hierarchy. In the European Lead Factory, we are working together, and as an SME with 50 people, some SMEs are even smaller, with academic partners, with big farmers that are doing billions of euro in sales, and yet we're working without a formal hierarchy on an equal basis. And the ELF creates a large global interactive population of researchers with different viewpoints, different experiences, and no single entity, be it a company, be it a research institute, could represent that. And now I'm going to show you a short video clip that TR Pharma has produced on the European Lead Factory, summarizing in 1.5 minutes what I'm going to talk to you later in 15 minutes. And please pay attention. I'll quiz you after that.
Academics or researchers from SMEs often have awesome ideas for new drugs to cure diseases, but limited ways to develop them. Companies with resources and academics with ideas were often focused on their own field, so nobody ever really joined forces. This was called the innovation gap. That's why the European Commission decided to team up with an association of big European pharmaceutical companies. They invited other companies, SMEs, and academics to join and anonymously share their knowledge and libraries of compounds. This was the start of the European Lead Factory. Simply put, we have a huge library of high-quality compounds that just keeps on growing. Any European researcher from academia or SMEs can submit a target assay or library idea for us to screen. All we need is an innovative target proposal with an assay meeting our technical requirements. A committee of independent and industry professionals will assess the proposal under confidentiality. If they like it, our experts and our screening robot will do their job. After which, you will receive a report of up to 50 hits from our library. Nice! You will open up business opportunities to develop that great new drug and provide patients with the cure they need. Would you like to know more? Click on one of the icons below for the next animation.
Well, I hope you got an overview on what we are doing at the European Lead Factory. And I would like to show you a little bit the highway of drug development. For the people who are familiar with it, it might be redundant, but I would like to show you, if this is the highway of drug development, we are covering exactly this gap in the hit-finding phase. There was a huge gap in the past exactly there. You have the academic partners oops, sorry. You had the academic partners that were focusing at the end of the day on innovative research. They were interested, where does a disease come from? What is the mechanism? On the other hand, we have pharma companies that are interested in producing a drug. And then you have all of a sudden that gap that has developed. On one hand, you have the excellence in academia for them to find the right hit, so to speak. They don't have the resources. On the other hand, the pharma partners, this is sometimes for them too early to understand what's going on, too risky to really get involved. And the European Lead Factory has built the bridge. If the IMI built the foundation or provide the foundation, we built the bridge to close exactly this gap. The European Lead Factory is a true pan-European drug discovery effort. It consists of two parts. There were two calls at the beginning. One was for the joint European compound library, which I'm in charge of, and the second part is the European Screening Center, for which Toyn Randers is in charge of, and he's also sitting here in the audience. And this together was merged after the first call and was created, so to speak, the European Lead Factory. The joint European compound collection consists of two parts. That's why it is called also joint. The first part is the compound collection that was contributed by the FPO partners. 300,000 compounds, to be exact, 326,000 compounds. And they're going to be complemented by a public compound collection of 200,000 compounds designed and produced on state-of-the-art research that is at the moment in the scientific community. The European Screening Center is basically responsible for the HTS, the high throughput screens, the compound logistics, the triaging, and the medicinal chemistry efforts for the improved hit list. And I will get to you in a minute back to this aspect. What we are looking for at the European Lead Factory is for novel targets, either novel targets or novel assay approaches, top scientific quality. We want defined molecular targets, and it has to be HTS compatible. On the chemistry side, we are looking for novelty. We are looking for scaffolds or molecules that are drug-like. We need diversity points in order to make the library as diverse as possible. Synthetic tractability, very important. What do I mean by that? It has to be payable at the end of the day. There has to be a balance. Sometimes in science we forget that whatever we produce, we also have to be able to pay for. And then we are also looking for innovation. What do people get for this? The target owners are getting a list of hit structures that have been identified according to criteria that the industry would also do so. And that was until now not accessible for most of the academic partners. The challenge has been over the last one year to convince the academic partners to drive across that bridge. You will be amazed how difficult that can be. Even though it is free of charge, even though they get at the end of the day the hit list and they can do with it whatever they want, it is very difficult to convince them. And I would like to address this, to bring back to your constitution, to really ask the academic partners to drive across the bridge. It's free. They get a very important piece of data with which they can push forward their drug discovery program. When we set up the European Lead Factory, we saw it actually rather relaxed, because we saw it as a large-scale controlled experiment in which we share the compound collections between FPIA in order to kickstart the whole project, create new compounds, create a new library, crowdsourcing for ideas for chemistry and biology from the outside world, from the academic community, to really have state-of-the-art work, partnering opportunities for public target programs. That means even an academic partner or even a biotech company found a very interesting hit list. We have the FPIA partners within the consortium in direct communication with these partners so that they can really fast forward a project. And last but not least, we were really focusing on value generation from the public-funded initiatives. Why? Because in my opinion, I think many of you will share this opinion, is if we create value, we should be able to exploit this value, we should be able to exploit it in Europe, generate taxes with the value that we generated, and the taxes at the end of the day is what funds the research. So it's a cycle that's necessary. So it is very important, even though we do open innovation, to really create value along the way. What is the process? What is really the way it works, the European Lead Factory? Well, you have an academic partner. He goes to our website. He signs up for the terms of use. He submits a target or he submits a library design. We have a selection committee, very important. We have we put a lot of time in putting these selection committees together. They're experts from SMEs, from academia, and from the FPIR partners, so that people look from all sides onto this project and really evaluate this project. Once the projects get selected, the people are asked to sign a form of a session, and then it gets processed within the European Lead Factory. I will not go into details how the process is, but I'll give you just this slide. What we are talking about is we are starting with 500,000 compounds. The partner will get a list of 50, maximum 50 compounds. But along the way, there are a lot of experts looking and working and doing research and filtering out all the compounds that might not be necessary. And that is a great effort, and there is a great team of experts that are doing that. And I'm saying that and I'm emphasizing that because I want to point out it's all about people, people, people. If any of these people would not put their part into the European Lead Factory, we would hit a roadblock. But I have to be really thankful to all my partners within the European Lead Factory because they are the ones who have made this happen. What happens once we have this qualified hit list, as we say? Well, the partner has the opportunity, he has exclusivity on the hit list for 3 years. He can file patents. He can work together with FPIR partners to develop drugs, and this is very important. We have to find a communication network which brings very quickly the knowledge that we are developing on the bench to the patient. And I think the gap between the bench and the patient has been way too long because there have been too many roadblocks, too many projects just have fallen into the water. And too much, I would say, taxpayers' money through that has been wasted. It is important that we form platforms of communication in order to bridge these gaps, and then we will be able to help the patients much faster than we have done in the past. What have been the achievements after 2.5 years in the European Lead Factory? I will spend only a few slides because we have published quite a bit on it. We are publishing on it, especially on the chemistry side, and you can look it up, and we have only 15 minutes, which is really limited. The FPIR partners delivered their compounds within the first few months of signing the project agreement to BioAscent, which is housed in Newhouse, which is compound logistics center. They plated the compounds within 8 months. We have to imagine within 8 months it was fully operational. The compounds were plated, delivered to the screening centers. The five chemistry public partners, they had a ramp-up phase. They delivered after 1 year the first 6,000 compounds, and that was already celebrated as a great success. But once we have reached as SME steady state, we can really perform, and we can really make things happen. And within 1 year, we delivered over 50,000 compounds. This is 14 months to be exact. We delivered 57,000 compounds. At this rate, we will reach our goal that we had set out at the beginning of 200,000 compounds, totaling the joint European compound collection to over 500,000 compounds. So we don't have to revise our proposal. We are right on target. How does it look for the biology? A very, very similar picture, to be honest. If you see there have been 86 proposals submitted. When we set out this project, there was an expert committee. They said, where would you get the ideas from? Are people willing to drive across the highway? But there have been very, very great efforts put to really publicize this project. And 48 have been accepted. That means we have submissions, but we are still keeping the quality of what gets processed further very high. I will not go through all the numbers. Five projects have been completed. Two improved hit lists have been delivered, and there is now a whole, so to speak, a wave that is coming on results in the next 12 months. We have published in scientific journals. The scientists that are involved within the consortium have been able to speak at conferences. The students have been able to present posters. We have had internal workshops where people, the postdocs, could present their work. We have been invited for a symposium by Bioorganic and Medicinal Chemistry Letters to publish, and we have their 13 papers. We have been invited in Drug Discovery Today to submit an article. There have been further invitations for book articles. So in the scientific community and the publications community, there has been a lot of motion and a lot of tracking has been activated. And last but not least, that is also quite an achievement, a software that has been developed in collaboration with BioVia has won the BioIT World Best Practice Award for the Science Cloud software, which is an honest data broker. The honest data broker basically protects the IP and the chemical structures of the compounds that have been submitted. If you want more details to this piece of software, please address Ton or me later on, and we will be able to explain it to you. But this has also been a very important aspect within the European Lead Factory. I will not go through this. This is just a rough timeline, how long a project works. But only the last aspect is really important to me, because one of the first ones to utilize this highway has been Hüb-Ova from the National Cancer Institute. And he made a comment, and that really hit the nail on the head what we wanted to achieve with the European Lead Factory. And I will quote, "Access to the European Lead Factory has forwarded our drug discovery program in the field of oncology by several years." And he basically means that. That is a very good example, and he was one of the first ones, as I mentioned, to utilize it. And all the other projects that come from academia have made similar comments. I have four or five case studies. I'm not going to present all of them, but basically it's all along that line. So I think whatever we set out in the European Lead Factory, we have achieved in terms of goals, but also in the results for the partners that are utilizing the European Lead Factory. These are just a few pictures how today research looks like. That's compound purification. You saw some robots at the beginning at the cartoon. They are real. This is actually how it looks today when we do drug discovery. This is in Oss, the screening center. This is the logistics in Neuhaus. This is where we store the compounds. It's quite impressive to visit. And the European Lead Factory really combines innovation of academia, the agility of SMEs, the experience of pharma, with the funding from IMI in order to really bridge that gap that we have had. And I think that IMI is doing a great job to identify the gaps that are out there on the highway and closing them, or providing facilities to close them. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and open for any questions.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah, so we'll take the questions afterwards, Dimitris. So that was one. That was the second type of consortia in IMI. Now, last third type looks at sharing knowledge. You know, how can we learn from not only successes but also failures when products and medicines get approved? Usually all the information around them become available, but we also fail a lot. And you can learn a lot from sharing information on failures. So one of the first consortia to actually deliver something concrete is the ETOX project, which Ferran Sanz is going to talk about. So thank you, Ferran, for coming.
Okay, thank you. I am pleased to present a little to you the experience of the ETOX project. The ETOX project is about the iterative strategies for predicting drug toxicities. And this project, as it was told, is a project of the first call, I think, of IMI, so started in January 2010. In principle, it had to finish by the end of last year, but after an ENSO grant, it has been extended for two additional years. And the consortium of this project is constituted, the laser pointer, is constituted by 13 pharma companies, plus 11 academic institutions, plus six medium enterprises. The budget of this project is a total of about 19 million euros. I would like to stress that most of this money is put by the peer companies and the rest by IMI. The motivation of this project is that there is a wealth of high quality toxicity data in the archives of the pharmaceutical companies that is not yet leveraged. So it constitutes a series of silos, hidden silos, that had an enormous value for better prediction of what will happen with new compounds. So on the basis of this reality, we decided that the project objectives, the ETOX project objectives, were the development of a framework for sharing of legacy preclinical legacy preclinical reports for pharmaceutical industry, complemented with information extracted from the public domain. The aim was to generate a toxicological database with high quality structural, in vitro and in vivo data, and with the aim of facilitating read across and development of predictive models for future compounds under development. The development of the predictive models will take advantage of integrative application of computational, chemoinformatics and bioinformatics approaches, and obviously if we want that the models are useful, they need and are carried out to an intensive validation of the predictive models within the FPIA companies and in collaboration with the regulators. So the scheme of the project is that on one side we have the reports coming from the FPIA companies, on the other side we have data extracted from the public domain. We extract data from both sides and we store all this information on an integrated database and in honest broker, that is LASA. This process is very easy to depict, but very complicated to do for many reasons. First, the confidence between the companies. Second, that the information in the different sources are in different formats, different units, and it's complicated to integrate to all this information. We did a huge effort in developing standards, in developing ontologies for making possible this integration. And also tools, text mining tools and other type of tools for this automatic extraction of information. Okay, I will talk about the reality today of this integrated database, that is a reality. Once we have this database is used by the modelers to develop this integrative predictive system for read across and with the models there. So the models are based, as I told you, in a series of modeling techniques. And I would like to stress that through the ENSO grant, we are linking this preclinical information with information about human safety. So we are linking the preclinical data with clinical data coming from clinical trials and from pharmacovigilance. Obviously, this is an iterative process, so the models that are developed are validated, are assessed internally in the pharmaceutical companies, and the process is continuous because we are collecting new data and we are developing better models, and the process is going on. Okay, what type of data we have? We have data on one side that is confidential, we call. This data that is confidential is data that is shared among the participants after signing secrecy agreements. We have the data that we call ETOX non-confidential, that is freely accessible to all the participants in the project. And we have data that we call public, that not only is accessible to the participants to the project without any restriction, is also accessible, the public, to everybody interested in this data. And what are the figures today? The figures today are that we have about 1,700 chemical structures for which we have more than 6,000 toxicological studies, high-quality toxicological studies. This is only the part of the database that corresponds to the data donated by the FPIA companies. In addition to this, we have thousands of data coming from the public domain extracted by our procedures, for instance, through our collaboration with the Open Facts IMI project. So the development of models for predicting in vivo events, toxicological events, on the basis of chemical structures of the compounds is a complicated, is a very, very complicated and challenging process. And we had to introduce innovative multi-stage, multi-scale processes for doing so. Just to give you an example, in 2011 we published this proof of concept of a multi-scale simulation system for predicting drug-induced cardiotoxicity. This paper has became a reference paper in the field of multi-scale modeling. So from this year it has received already 40 citations, and it's a paper in which we describe a system that performs simulations at three levels. The simulation of the ion channels blockade of several ion channel blockade at the molecular level, then at the cellular level the simulation of a cardiomyocyte electrophysiology, and at the tissue level the simulation of the electrical propagation through a model of ventricular tissue. And at the end of the day we obtain a simulated electrocardiogram. So, okay, this is very complicated, but at the end of the day, for a user of the system, this implies that the input is the 2D structure of a possible drug, and like in a black box we can say, all these stages are done, and at the end the user obtains the possible electrophysiological electrocardiogram alteration, the elongation or not of the QT. So this is the type of simulation that we would like to carry out, and in this prototype this is already possible, it is already running. Okay, and how many models we have today? We have 74 models already developed that are being submitted to testing by the FPIA companies. And a point that I would like to stress is that we have developed a tool that we call ETOX Lab. That is, this ETOX Lab tool simplifies all the process of model development and maintenance. So, because it's very important that the models are updated with new data, and it's possible to say to see the different versions of the models corresponding to the different data that is available a long time. Another point in which we have worked, and that is very important, is the documentation of the models. So for each of the models, of these 74 models that we have developed, there is a feature in which you can see all the details about the methodology used for developing the models, and also about the quality of the predictions of the models. So, in fact, we have developed a new methodology that we call ADAN, that has been published, for estimating the reliability of the predictions and produce understandable results in terms of the quality of the predictions. So this is a screenshot of the ETOX-SEAS. It's the system for interrogating the database and the predictions. On one side you have this button for navigating into the database. On the other side you have this button for producing predictions. You can interrogate the database by just putting here the extraction, the 2D extraction of the compound in which you are interested, the new compound in which you are interested, or you can filter the database saying, okay, I am interested, for instance, to see all the compounds in the database that report an increase in aspartate transaminase. And then you obtain, for instance, the output of this search, that is 25 compounds that report an increase in this enzyme, in the clinical chemistry of this enzyme. If we concentrate, for instance, in one of them, and we click, we can see for this compound there are a series of studies report, and we can see that there are these particular studies here in which for particular rats or mouse, I don't remember, it is report an increase of aspartate in these terms here. On the other hand, we can draw a molecule and to interrogate particular predictions for this molecule. And we can see that for this particular model, for different models, for this particular molecule, we have different models for predicting, for instance, I don't remember this one, but a particular property, and we can see for a particular one there is a prediction that is positive. We can go inside and see what is the method used for this particular prediction. Okay, finally, I would like to stress in my last slides what are for us the outcomes for the scientific community that we have produced up to now. First of all, I would like to clarify that by the moment, the access to the ETOXIS, to this system that I have shown, is restricted to the ETOX consortium members. But we are committed to release to the scientific community results that do not compromise the confidentiality of the proprietary material contributed by the peer companies. What is the type of results that we are releasing to the scientific community? Obviously the public data, the part of the data that the peer companies consider that is not confidential. We are open to share this data with other partners. And in fact, we have a simple protocol for requesting access to this data. The ontologies, the thousands of standardized terminology that we have developed within the project is public. Everybody can access to these ontologies and can use these ontologies. This ETOX lab modeling framework is public. Everybody is open source. Everybody can use it. The tools for the assessment of the applicability domain of the models are public. Everybody can use them, and so on. So there are many results in the project that we are making public to everybody, and all the community are reusing these results in other projects. So what is finally my personal feeling about this project coming from academia? After many years of participating in different EU-funded projects and in other type of collaborative projects. For me, the experience of this project has been unique in terms of the intensity of the collaboration between the pharmaceutical companies, the academia, and a series of very active small medium enterprises. Second is that at the beginning of the project, it was a dream. The dream of information sharing between pharmaceutical companies was only a dream. And this project has been a first, I think, or one of the first experiences
of effective sharing of an important amount of information between the pharmaceutical companies. So today, this sharing is already a reality. Almost 2,000 compounds, almost 7,000 toxicological studies of high quality that never were shared among the pharmaceutical companies. Third, synergies with other projects. We have established strong synergies with other IMI projects and outside IMI too. For instance, two examples, OpenFax for extracting information from the public domain, or IPI, a new IMI project for studying the impact of drugs in the environment. We are collaborating intensively with this project, reusing a lot of the methodology we have developed for developing models for predicting this impact in the environment. Finally, sustainability. In many projects, the problem is sustainability. Once the project finishes, then the initiative disappears. In our case, the pharma companies are committed from the beginning to pay a maintenance fee after the end of the project to keep the tools, the database and the tools considered useful alive after the end of the project, and we are now putting in place all these procedures. Okay, if you are interested in reading more about this project, obviously we can go, for instance, to the last paper we published explaining the project, or even better, you can go to the webpage of the project and where you will find information about the progress of the project, but also access to the PARS, ontologies, and other, the ETOX lab, and so on, the tools that are public. You can access to them here in our database. Okay, thank you to all of you for your attention, and I will be pleased to talk with you about our experience and our challenges that we still have. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ferran. It's fascinating. It's so fantastic to see how IMI has, with several examples here, catalyzed change in behavior. And I remember Stavros Malas, who sits here from Cyprus, when Stavros was health minister of Cyprus and chair of the state representatives group. The first time I met you, you said this. You said that for me, IMI is an incubator for change. And indeed, this is what we see. And I agree with you absolutely, Ferran, that we're probably at the beginning of a journey towards data sharing big time between companies and academics. Now, we are going to have time now, almost half an hour, for Q&A and challenges and discussion. Now, I wonder if I can stand, I have to ask the people managing the webcast here, if I can stand in front of the speakers or if they have to come up to the podium here. We can be down here, okay, very good. So can I have this mic instead then, maybe?
I can roam around a little bit. So do we have any questions either from the app or from the room here to any of the speakers? Do we have more mics or only this one? There's a question here on the fourth row.
But I was a bit surprised that only 50 hits were presented to the group that submitted the assay, and I presume that the reason is because you want to protect the confidentiality of most of the compounds in the library. But there is, of course, a lot of useful information beyond those 50 top hits. Even negative results of related compounds help to establish, for instance, the structure-activity relationship. So would there be an intermediate way where the European Lead Factory actually does that analysis in-house and provides the results of that analysis that are based not just on those 50 compounds, but on the complete results, so that you don't have to disclose them, but the requesters get the benefit of that analysis?
Can I expand that question to you, so it's even broader, because I want to come back to this myself, this whole
which you said at the end, the honest data broker, because what's behind your question, of course, is not only beyond 50, but the data, the knowledge behind the compounds, because something may have been tried on something and failed. So that knowledge, which we all need to tap into for purposes of repurposing and everything that people are excited about. So Dimitris, could you also address that, the data brokering, how the surrounding and accompanying preclinical or even clinical data maybe is shared with the people that get the list of hits?
Well, the honest data broker was set up in order to protect the IP of the compounds that were submitted by the FPR partners, also by the public partners. If we would lay open all the data, all the structures, and in no time, let's say, the IP protection would be exhausted of the library. So the hit list that people are getting are actually, as we call it, the qualified hit list, and we say the improved hit list. The improved hit list, actually, there is a set of experts that are looking actually at the hit list, and they're triaging it and filtering it accordingly. So the hit list that the people are getting are already filtered by a certain set of experts, because we are doing certain assays, and we're looking for false negatives and so on. So this is all being performed. So the hit list that the people are getting at the end of the day is the way that the industry would move forward with compounds. So it's not just a hit list based on some initial screen first assays, but there are secondary assays and tertiary assays in order to guarantee the quality of the hits. And in terms of the honest data broker, basically till the end of the delivery of the hit list, the structures are not accessible. At one point, the structures are accessible when we are below 1,000 to a core set that is, I think that Ton can tell you a little bit more about it, to a core set of people where people look and their experience from the industry. So they're not FPR partners, but they are people, experts, that are looking at these hit lists, and then they are selecting the compounds accordingly based on the data. But the problem is we want to protect the IP around the libraries that are being donated by the FPR partners.
Yeah, this is also what IMI is all about. It's about having people collaborate much more than before, but yet not destroy the underlying business model for both biotech and for pharma. And I guess this is maybe one of the biggest successes also with IMI, is that there is a very solid IP policy which has enabled companies to come in and play. But the whole data sharing dimension is something that we need to continue to work on. That's very clear. Now, there was another question just next to you here. Yes, sir.
You asked about negative results, which are also very important. And we do add negative compounds, inactive compounds, on the qualified hit lists if we identify them to be belonging to the same chemical series, and giving that information around emerging SAR. And also I'd like to add that we also add all the biological data associated with the 50 compounds and all the statistical data around the screens and the secondary screens and whatever we've done. So you get a wealth of data around these 50 compounds that will really give you a starting point for a drug discovery program, and not just 50 structures. There's a lot more.
That answered the question that I added, that you actually get all that knowledge as well with the structures. So there's another question here.
Hello, good morning. First, I want to address really many thanks to our first keynote speaker. You really gave a compelling testimony of what it means to live with a chronic disease and condition. So my question goes to the education and training part. In this respect, is there research, foreseen interesting research in terms of compliance? Because this is also an important piece of information, in particular for chronic disease follow-up with drug development, for example, in terms of anything connected, device, sensors, education. Is this something in the roadmap that can be foreseen?
Thank you. I can give you a very short answer to that question. At the moment, there hasn't been anything specifically within the education training programs looking at compliance, but that is on the screen, so to speak. Clearly, it's an important aspect in terms of response to therapies in the future in terms of overall healthcare. My understanding is that within IMI too, within the strategic research agenda, there are areas there to address compliance, but it hasn't been done yet. Rich, I don't know if you want to comment.
Yeah, well, maybe if I can invite Magda Klebertz, who is really the brain and the hard worker at FPI, even stand up, I can introduce you. Magda will speak later today. She's my science director at FPI, and she's driving all the IMI activities. Now, we have something underway, don't we, for IMI 2, specifically on this. Maybe you can say a few words on this.
Without disclosing anything about the next sessions, because otherwise you would leave without coming to the session, so please come. But I would say just watch the space, because one of the projects that we are going to present later on in session three about big data health outcomes would be that. And thank you for the suggestion, because I think that you're right. Compliance adherence are parts that we didn't address sufficiently. So stay tuned for session three.
Now, I'm also happy to see, when I looked at the participants list here, we have a number of representatives from the IT industry and mobile phone technology industry, which is fantastic, because these people have lots of ideas, and sometimes they don't understand why the health people are not moving, you know, hiding behind the regulators, hiding behind the lawyers, but you know, so we need to intensify that collaboration. Now, we have a...
No.
Who's the next one in line? Over there? Okay.
Yeah. Now, how do we check for their scientific integrity in terms to avoid any unbiased behavior, namely, for instance, bias against a project, a treatment, or else?
Thank you. I'm not sure I'm actually the best person in the audience to answer that question, but I'll try. I think what we saw in the past is that there was no process, or there was no formal process, for ensuring that some of the patient experts or the advocates actually had a comprehensive understanding of the medicine's development process. They were experts in their own disease, they represented their own groups. But often it was quite difficult for them to participate, whether that was sort of regulatory advisory boards or with industry or with other areas. So the focus has been very much on developing this cohort, making sure information is available so that these people have access to the information. That's one part of it. When I ask my colleagues at the moment what does happen, there isn't a formal screening process to see what education or what training some of the patient advocates have had. They're very highly motivated. They don't necessarily have all of that background information. And we are, or within the project, people are now looking at how do you match up the requirement, let's say, from a scientific advisory group or from another scientific group who require particular expertise, and almost that dating between those patient advocates who have it. The bit that talks about, you know, what background those patients have and to what extent they're able to give a broad description covering all sorts of diseases, I think we're always going to be limited, but the focus has, let's make sure we have very skilled advocates who are able to give the best possible advice.
Yes, and we have the EUPATI program as well, led by European Patients Forum, that addresses this. Plus that the European Medicines Agency, I don't know if anyone is here from the EMA, but they are spending a lot of time coaching, bringing patient representatives along. So it's very, very common now that when there is a scientific advice given, or there is a scientific advice given around the approval, that there are patient representatives. And these are not just someone you pull off the street, if I say so. These are people that are known to the agency, they've been there before, you know, they have learned about methodology, they've learned about drug development. So the EMA plays a very important role here in coaching the patient community to come along. I don't know, Anders, do you want to say something about EUPATI, or in general? Anders Olausson is the president of the European Patient Forum, and he's going to give the end note of the day today.
I will respond to it later today, if you're still here then. In my words...
That's a good incentive for staying, thank you.
No, I don't know, but I think it's two questions you're saying. One is competence and one is ethic. competence is quite clear and quite easy to solve. Ethic as well, because if I am presented with secret material or material that can be dangerous for that company if you share it to someone else, then of course I have to sign and I have to comply with the same rules as everyone else. So for me it's quite easy. And we need to deliver some programming and how to do that and formulating that, and that is what we're doing in UPATI. So I'm not worried about your question. But I'm concerned.
Okay. That is good with a bit of debate as well. So please.
You resolved the question with a confidentiality agreement, but it is more deep than that. Let's say the representative can have some biases against the treatment beyond any formal interest in the treatment from a financial point of view, for instance. So how do you clear for something that ultimately should be as much objective as possible?
Again, that goes in competence. But if that patient, why don't you see that his biased attitude can be something good to the project? It is, I can see another way to describe it is that he is double critical. And from what we're hearing now is that can be a good thing. So again, with the relation, we have to learn about the relation. And that is one of the things I will come back on. And that is that we have a shift of culture, what we are talking about here. So this kind of problem will occur more and more and more. We have to learn from that. And the only way to learn from it is like doing now, meeting each other, and to continue to doing that. But I will address it 5:30 tonight. You're welcome.
Okay. John-Peter, did you want to comment on this? Yes, show it. Show it for the web viewers as well.
I hope I'm a patient. I'm academic. I'm European. I have a master in European public health. Many of my fellow patients, are also having a PhD in medicine and are working in all kinds of pharma industry, but are not. Are a little bit afraid to say that they are patients, because the moment that they say, well, I'm a patient, at that moment we are not taken totally full anymore. So maybe the question is coming from that direction about competency. We have quite a lot of patients that they are more than aware and competent enough to sit in all kinds of commissions and so on. Jan Keijzer of EPATI, my nice colleague, is working on that. But we are having, for example, Bettina, who is actually a researcher on melanoma, and she's also a patient advocate. So don't be afraid about having patience on all this stuff, having a very high literacy and at the same time a high ethic knowledge about their colleague patients. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, so do we have any, maybe we can move to another topic. Question over here.
John Cleland, European Society of Cardiology. We're very interested in developing this area, but within cardiology, very much therapeutic devices and remote monitoring and acquisition of data in that way are very much part of what we do. So looking at IMI2, it looks very pharmaceutical orientated. Is that a limitation for us?
No, I think we have added in IMI2, we have greater flexibilities. We have introduced on the side of FPR, we have something called Partners in Research, where we've already let in some 10 different companies from different sectors. So we have what I call the enabling sector. So you have technology providers, we have imaging companies, we have meditech, and we even have consulting companies that are brokers in between. Contract research organizations are very welcome to join in on the side of setting up the consortia. Then we have on the public side, with JDRF having joined, we have the possibility for also learned societies to join on either of these sides. It depends on whether you want to be a contributor of resources in,
and with your knowledge, or whether you want to be a recipient of support potentially from the European Commission money. So we have much greater flexibilities now to do exactly that, because our researchers have been telling us that it's all coming together. We see the convergence of technologies, convergence of disciplines, right? And the pharma industry is like one super tanker in the middle of this armada of all sorts of ships. You know, we need to be able to work together. So you're more than welcome, more than welcome. And I think the medical profession needs to be front and center in many of these programs as we go forward. So any more questions? Anything on the web, on the app? On Twitter? Questions? No? Oh, maybe we are a bit more conservative crowd here. Any more questions? I'd like to come back to this honest broker idea and invite the three speakers or maybe Ferran to comment a bit more on this, because how would you go about that? This could potentially be quite big. I mean, this data sharing, if people, either you want to have people, things in the cloud so everybody can see it, but a lot of this you have to somehow protect, as you said, okay? So how do you see that?
This is a crucial point for getting the confidence required for a project of information sharing, for instance. I remember that at the beginning of the talks, the selection of this honest broker, the organization that will keep the information confidential and non-confidential control under very strict rules from the legal and technological point of view, because it's important not only put countermeasures from the technological point of view, but also from the legal point of view. There are a lot of paperwork to be done in this respect. So was a crucial point. Once we had this organization, and once everybody started to seeing that everything worked smoothly, the donation of data started to be increasingly easier and easier. So, but at the beginning, it's important to select well the organization with a clear, in this case, is a foundation participated by many pharmaceutical companies. That has the profile adequate for playing this role. Second, to establish a clear structure from the technological point of view, from the procedural point of view, from the legal point of view, for all the transactions of information to be carried out. At the same time, has to be flexible enough to allow the work, because at the end of the work, information have to circulate and the models have to be built up. So, and we succeeded. Obviously, maybe this will be a particular experience for a lecture to explain, not myself, but the organization carrying out this work, to explain all the experience.
Yeah, I think that would be very interesting to tap into that, but how do you build this trust? And it goes back to the question we had before here about bringing patients along as well. Okay, so I'd like to ask Mike a quick, going back to skills and brains. I had the chance, was 2 weeks ago, I was in Boston together with the European Research Commission, Moedas, and he was hosting a round table with people from the Boston ecosystem. So from the teaching hospitals, from the universities, and lots of startup companies, and some of my big members were there also. One thing that came back, because we were the Europeans going there, we all asked the same question: how come you've been so successful in attracting all this research, retaining it and attracting people from all around the world to come to Boston? And one part of the answer was that the medical, they said the schools are flexible in developing the curriculums. So the individuals have an ability, so students, even at medical school, pharmacy school, so your primary, not primary education, but your basic training, that you have the chance to pick and choose. And you can do computer science, and you can do something on the biology side. And it's encouraged even to do that. And it's facilitated by the different universities in Boston to work together to make sure that people can do it, because we need more of this. Back to the convergence of the scientific disciplines. Now, where is Europe on this, Mike?
Are we the universities in particular? I mean, I guess you focused a lot of what you talked about was postgraduate training, but the basic university curriculums in Europe, do we have this mindset in Europe as well? And if so, where?
I think it's fair to say at the moment that, let me describe it, maybe we're lagging behind. I think within the university environment, there's still a more traditional approach to the academic topics, to making sure that people have what has historically always been seen to be important. But when we look at the jobs that people are doing, and we look at the sorts of ways that people are working, that isn't a one-to-one match with the way that people are trained. So whether you're a biologist or a pharmacist, you're now working in cross-functional teams with a whole range of people. And in many cases in Europe, that's difficult to introduce these things into the curricula. I think we need to do it, which is one part of it. But not only that, you need to continue doing it. Because no matter how much you've done your first stages of education, there will be new things that come along. So if you see it as Lego blocks, and I think what you're describing are different Lego blocks that people learn about in their basic education or as they go through universities, you have to keep adding new Lego blocks so that you can then adapt to this changing environment. So I think within the universities in Europe, we would like to see a lot more of this flexibility. It's not there yet, but you certainly need this element of increased flexibility after that, otherwise you can never reflect the rapid changes and you'll always have gaps and will always suffer from it.
So I think this is an area which is of great importance, and in FPI we've had this reflection as well, is that we want Europe to stay competitive, we want people to be educated here and stay here and continue to work here in the ecosystems of Europe. So we need to make sure that we do engage with universities. So do you want to comment on this? And I have one final question before the break.
I would like to explain a personal experience just on this. I think a success story. At the beginning of ETOX project, we incorporated a German lady to make the PhD with us. This lady also worked in ETOX and OpenFax in work on knowledge management, did a fantastic PhD. Then she went for a postdoc in Stanford in the States, but she did not stay there in the States. She has came back to Europe to work at Roche in Germany. And once arrived there in Germany at Roche, he has established a contract of collaboration with us, with her alma mater, for working in knowledge management area, big data area with us. So this is an example. So from Germany to Spain for a PhD, then in this area, knowledge management for pharmaceutical research, going to Stanford, going back to Europe, pharmaceutical industry, and then collaboration with academia in Spain for doing so.
Good example, but it does work. Did you want to have a final?
The possibility in Europe is becoming now, is happening now. I mean, you can see for the first diploma student going to university and studying two different, area fields of discipline. It could be computer science and business, for instance, and this was not possible earlier, but maybe there is no work which has been developed in terms of communicating this program enough, but they are existing.
Okay, that's good to know. Okay, so I think we will stop here now for, was there a question from the web?
Yes, we have a question on our app.
Okay.
So it's from Françoise Busquet, who's asking how much EU regulators at national levels are involved within the IMI project's deliverables. Are they cooperative with the new tools and or paradigms?
Well, this is a good question, and one thing that's not so commonly known actually is that the European Medicines Agency rely on the national regulators for most of the work. I hope I don't step on any toes. EMA is supposed to be a secretariat. Okay. Now, there's a lot of clever people there that understand science, but that project management is done by the EMA. The actual workforce is in the countries. So, yes, the answer from
It's definitely yes. The experts that are working in the European regulatory system, they are rapporteurs, they're evaluating side effects and so on. They are involved, increasingly involved in the IMI programs. So I would expect that once the technology comes along, that the regulatory side of it is okay. My real headache, and it almost keeps me up at night, is the fact that we have HTA, health technology assessment, and payers and health systems which have not been engaged and which will say, what is this? Either they'll say, I don't understand this, or they'll say, I didn't ask for this. I did not order this. This happens. And that's a real shame, particularly if patients are waiting and we did get the order from the patients and from the physicians. So this is our next wave of inclusion in IMI, is that we need to involve these people in as many of the consortia as we can. And you will hear, we'll hear more about this, particularly about the Big Data for Better Outcomes program, which is all about involving health systems and their representatives in IMI. So Irene, do you want to close the morning?
First, I just wanted to add on to what you were saying. So European Medicines Agency are participating to IMI in a number of different ways, both sometimes to help us define a topic correctly, sometimes they are a partner in projects, and sometimes they are in advisory role to particular project. It all depends on the scope and the nature of the project, because of course what's very important is for the regulatory bodies is to not compromise their independence as well. So they can play a number of different roles, and we will hear more about that from Corinne De Vries from European Medicines Agencies, who will be part of the next session, where I think she will tell us a little bit more about EMA's role for IMI.
Okay. So thank you to the speakers of the panel. Thank you to Anders for setting the stage and the right tone and the direction of travel for all of us. Thank you very much, and I wish you bon appétit.